In 2018, we were running vertical tillage after our corn. We had been combining in one field east of town, kind of in that system, chisel plow, vertical tillage system, and it was wet, and we were running the grain cart. We couldn't pull into the field with the trucks. It was just too wet. And we're leaving ruts with the combines and the grain cart just because that's just how it was. So we got done with that field, and we moved to the no-till corn-on-corn train wreck. The tires are wet. I mean, that soil is wet. It's saturated. But we're not leaving ruts. There's no mud stuck on the tires. We could pull into the field with the semi. And it was pretty neat to see the differences, that this soil is different. This is the third year of no-till. That this soil can carry a load, yet it's still saturated. And, you know, it's not goop. It's a very different soil structure. So, and I noticed that throughout the year after these 3-4 inch rainfall events, that I could drive out there with the Ranger and not sink in, and I can walk next to the pond and the water squishes out, and I've shared some of these videos with Holly, that the water squishes out and you move your foot and it goes right back in, and you're not sinking in at all. And there's all the residue on the surface and all sorts of bugs crawling around. And that was a Wednesday in July, a couple days after 4-inch rainfall event, and I told my dad, I said, this is pretty neat, you got to come see this. And we went out on Thursday and the water is gone, the pond is gone. It was probably 4 inches deep. The beans in the pond are green, they'd been there for a couple days, they look just as good as the stuff not in the pond. There's no tile there. There's a county tile, but it runs diagonal, but not right there. The next day the pond is gone, and the neighbor who's 30 feet across the fence in the conventional tillage system, same soil type, I mean, we're 30 feet apart. My pond's gone, he still has a pond. And when we came back later to after the 10 inches of rain, and I seeded a cover in those drowned out areas, mine was dry, his was a pond. When we harvested the beans in the fall of 2018, he had a pond still on his. I drove through my cover crop drowned out area. There's no mud, there was no pond. So, same tile, we had in that one, there's a county tile that goes kitty corner from mine into his. No pond, he has a pond. The difference is the tillage system. So, from that very first year, was pretty apparent. Now, this spring, that one conventional till farm that we had that I had to work it, I just didn't like it. The fuel usage to plant that field after the fuel cultivator had been worked, and versus a strip till, was almost twice as much fuel consumption just to plant it. You know, you got that 6 inches of loose, soft soil versus the firm, unworked areas between our strips. It was almost twice as much fuel just to plant that. And the crop is actually a little more uneven due to wheel tracks and compaction. What I really liked about the strip was it was an even seed bed, and you're driving on unworked soil, so it takes less power to motivate through the field just because you're not sinking in, and the efficiencies and stuff. So it was pretty noticeable, and with the newer tractors and stuff, you could easily measure that. So I could quantify, that's taking 15 gallons an hour to plant in the conventional tillage versus 7 to 6.5 to 8, depending on hills and stuff, in the strip till. So it carries a load so much better. We've experienced a lot of learning opportunities through our journey and transition from conservation tillage to now more this strip-till, no-till, vertical tillage system. 2014, we seeded a cover crop with our VT tool after sweet corn. The spring of 2015, we had this cereal rye that was great. It was 30 inches, 3 foot tall. Our soybeans get planted a little later usually, just depending on if they're coming from winter production or not. But we thought more is better. Let's have more. And 2015 in Southwest Minnesota, not a lot of people planting into rye. So we did what we should do, right? We sprayed it, we thought we can't run a field cultivator in this tall rye, so we ran our VT tool, let's chop it up. What we learned was cereal rye has a huge root ball, a root mass, and now we had these big lumps. And how are we going to plant into that? We can't plant into that. So looking now, it was foolish. We ran our field cultivator now after our vertical tillage because we got to bust these lumps up. And then we planted it. And it was lumpy and rough, and we had uneven seeding depth with our soybeans, and some were on the surface and some were down low. And we have all this residue, and we used Fierce as a pre-emerge that, you know, is now on all this residue. And that's a three day, you got to spray that within 3 days of planting, because if you have soybean emergence with Fierce and Valor and any of those, it's going to kill the soybeans. Well, guess what? it rained the day that the beans were just cracking through, and it washed off of the residue, and we lost a lot of soybeans. So we learned, one, let's not till that rye up because we have so big of a, so many root balls. Two, let's change our pre-emerge herbicide and not have that. But what we did notice from that first year of planting soybeans into or after a rye cover crop was, one, we're not going to till it. Two, we're going to change our pre-emerge, but we had way better weed control in that part of the field than where we didn't have the rye. Night and day different where that was. And where we actually had beans that the Valor didn't kill, they yielded better. We didn't have the soil movement. And that field doesn't have quite the topography changes that others do, but a big basin, and a lot of things went wrong that first year. The second year, we did the rye after the sweet corn, and we'd have this rye planted in rye, oats, radish mix, planted early September, and we found rye roots 3 feet down as we're digging our starting holes to tile. And you're talking 6 weeks and we got roots 3 feet, and that's doing something. And the rye in the fall doesn't get very tall above ground, but here we're seeing roots 3 feet below ground. So that was really apparent. Planting those soybeans in 16, we decided we're gonna terminate it because not many people were planting green then. We terminated it. We did run our sunflower, but then we rolled it ahead of time to flatten the roots, the root balls, and planted that. So, and changed our pre-emerge herbicide to Outlook. So we had a smoother seed bed to get more even seeding depth and not have those big root balls. And then we didn't have the herbicide issue. The downside we have with our soybeans is we have multiple different varieties in a field. So that was a 1X field. That field probably had 30 to 40 different soybean varieties. So it's really hard to compare yield with a cover crop region and a non-cover crop region because they're all different soybean varieties. It's too many variables to compare yield-wise. But to look at the crop and to compare height where the rye was, they were healthier beans, they closed the row faster, and the weed control was better. And we have a cheaper pass versus a field cultivator pass. We can pull the VT tool 8.5 miles an hour and versus 7 and whatnot. But we really liked that. 2017, we changed a little bit. We didn't pull that, we sprayed it, sprayed the rye. We just planted into the dead residue, getting rid of a pass. Same thing we saw. That one was not a 1X field, so we did see higher yield where we had the rye versus where we didn't have the rye. And that one was probably about that 3-4 bushel better. That was before we really had the analytical software to pull different regions and really compare. 2018 was the first year we planted soybeans into rye green, and that was also the first year we had the software and the technology to really compare and analyze this region versus this region. And what we saw in 18 was, and that field had three different soybean varieties in it, but they were bigger, 50 acre varieties. So one variety in the rye versus the same variety outside the rye, right next to each other, the rye, no-till into the green rye. We did not spray a pre-emerge because that rye was probably 18 inches tall. There's no weeds. We sprayed it, killed it off with Roundup, so we still had a sprayer pass, but $4.75 an acre for Roundup versus $15 for Outlook or generic dual or whatever, like the, we'll call it conventional, got. It had been VT'd in the fall and then a field cultivator in the spring. Where the rye was, that variety was 6.3 bushel better than the no rye. And you can see it with the regions that we created. We used field view, 6.3 bushel better that variety where there was rye, where there wasn't. And it's really neat because you can break it down by yield by elevation, yield by soil type, yield by topography. And where we gained the most was on the hills. 2018, a wet year, we had adequate rainfall on all farms. Why did we yield more soybeans on the hills where we had rye versus where we didn't have rye? And what we thought was, we've changed that soil a little bit. After sweet corn, we had a good cover crop grown in the fall, came back in the spring. We had all that root action, that we have changed that soil that now we can absorb more moisture on the hills so it doesn't run off to the bottom. So even on a year with lots of rain, I think we had more staying on the hills where we had the cover crop than where we didn't. It was a 13 bushel difference on those hilltops. You add 6 bushels at $9, you're at $72 an acre. Subtract the expenses of a tillage pass and the herbicides, you know, maybe another $30 there, you're at $100 more an acre where we had the rye. That was that variety. The other variety was a 1 bushel or a 0.96 bushel difference. That still is a financial gain. It's a bushel, so you gain $9 there, but you save $30 by just no-tilling into the rye and not spraying a pre-emerge herbicide. Boy, that makes sense. 2019, we continued to plant into the rye. 2020, we planted some corn this year into rye with the early maturity soybeans and harvest. We have a great window to seed some covers. So we strip-tilled some into rye, planted into that. You know, I really like that system for the nutrient placement that the strip-till gives me, but still having the cover crops between the strips and maybe not having any nitrogen tie-up issues with that. The corn that we planted into the cereal rye looks really good.